Okay, thank you very much for opening up the session, René, and thank you for the invitation from the Agile Consortium. That's really, really great. I just felt a little bit excluded by your new initiative, Agile for People Under 35. Like, oh my God, that's a long time ago. The crazy thing is even, I only started with this thing called Agile and Scrum at the age of 33. So that's how the world has changed in the meantime. So welcome everybody. And I'm indeed happy to talk a little bit about the Scrum values. I've got some stuff prepared also. I'm going to ask René to keep an eye on the chat or the whatever. René, if you see questions popping up, they see, wow, this is really interesting. Just politely try to
interrupt me. I will.
You never know if I stop talking or not, but at least give it a try, interrupt me. I hate Q&A sessions by the end of the session. That's so waterfall. No, let's all mix that and work in sort of iterative incremental way. Okay, great. Thanks. Thank you all for being here. Let me share the screen so I can share what I've prepared. So all that hard work and updating that sort of last minute is what I always do. So it's great to talk about the Scrum values. And indeed, like you said, René, it's about the value in the Scrum values, at least where I see the value in the Scrum values, what I think is the value in the Scrum values. So let's have a look. So, but let me first start a little bit by going back into the history of Scrum. It's funny that we just have Agile for under 35 old people. That's really, really young. I started with this thing called Agile and Scrum, actually with extreme programming, by the way, back in 2003. At the age of 33, so I was born in 1970. So people that are good at mathematics, they now have calculated that I'm 51 years old in the meantime. That's true. And last year, by the end of last year, I decided to have a quick look back at the history of Scrum. Because Scrum, as we all know, was officially 25 years old by then. For being born in 1995, there had just been an update of the Scrum Guide. And I was like, yeah, let's look back at the history of Scrum. I created a paper about it, called it Scrum, A Brief History of a Long-Lived Hype. Just sort of inside joke for myself. Maybe that sounds weird, I know. But I remember the days when I started with Scrum that we didn't call it Scrum. We didn't use the name Scrum. We didn't use the name Agile either back in 2003 because people had no idea what it was. They probably thought it was some sort of virus and they were afraid of some sort of pandemic by then. Although in the end, Scrum really harmless, as you know. That started changing as from 2005, 2006. And as we started using the name Scrum and Agile more, I remember those days and saying, yeah, but you know what? Because people thought, a lot of people still thought it was a hype, it was going to blow away again. And I used this idea of, yeah, but you know what? How long has Scrum been around? 1995, and now 2005. That's 10 years old. That's not even a hype anymore. So I'm sort of looking back at that. So I listed up some things in the history of Scrum, but let me pick out a couple of what I called in my paper, a couple of landmarks, very important things. Where we got the name Scrum from, 1986, that paper from those two Japanese professors, the new product development game. 1995, it said that was the official presentation of Scrum, introduction of Scrum to the general audience at the OOPSLA event in the US. By the way, do notice also 1995, 1999, very important paper, by the way. I should call it a landmark too, by the way. After that, we stopped writing Scrum in capitals. So since those days, we started writing Scrum in capital S for me, but then no capitals, because it's not an acronym, it's not an abbreviation, it's just Scrum. It refers to the game of rugby, like, you know, in the paper, the new product development game. Next highlight, 2001, as we all know, the Manifesto for Agile Software Development. It's where we got the name Agile from. It shows that I'm quite old because in my classes, I always ask people, do you know the name Azov, where does it come from? And more people don't know anymore. I don't know whether that should be scary or not. I have no idea. The thing that we generally call the Azov Manifesto. And then in 2010, an important step, the Scrum Guide, first version of Scrum Guide, actually born, as you might read in my paper, already in 2009, but then officially launched in 2010 by Ken and Jeff. And it had several updates since then. So just some landmarks in the history of this long-lived hype that we call Scrum. Now, just an overview of Scrum. Now, what about the Scrum values? I don't know if anybody knows, so I did the same. The Scrum values were for the first time ever were described back in 2002 in the first ever book about Scrum, which was called Agile Software Development with Scrum. It's by Ken Schreiber and the late Mike Beadle. And they described the Scrum values in a sort of annex, an appendix almost of the book. They described it as traits or characteristics that they saw emerging in teams and people that were using Scrum, that were applying Scrum. So that was 2002. And then actually, honestly, the Scrum values in a way completely went silent. Everybody's focused on certifying and the CSM, and then afterwards Scrum the talk and people recertifying or whatever and talking about the rules. And then there was this this Scrum Guide launched in 2010. So, and I remember by the end of 2012, so 10 years after the first description of the Scrum values, and they were never documented, described, discussed, whatever, in that decade, those 10 years that had passed by then. I remember being in a class, a professional Scrum class that I teach, a product owner class, and there was a candidate trainer, so I was also training trainers. And he asked me about, hey, Gunther, the Scrum values, where are they? Are they still alive? Are they still relevant? Do we still believe in them? Are they still vibrant and so on? And said, well, honestly, I don't know. They feel very important to me still. So I went back to Ken Schreiber, sent him a little mail saying, hey, Ken, remember Scrum values described in your book over 10 years ago? How do you feel about the values? And said, well, I personally still think, like you seem to do, Gunther, that they're really, really important. Except nobody talks about them. I've never put them on the table, neither. So I said, wow, I think there is value in the Scrum values. So I wrote in 2013 a blog note about it, and then added them to my book, which is called Scrum, A Pocket Guide. First edition that I published back in 2013. And in the meantime, that blog note that I created, the value in the Scrum values, is the most read blog note on my blog ever. I will never, ever in my life publish something again that will have so much attention and that people will read and keep reading. So it doesn't mean that my life is over, by the way. It just means there's something, it resonates with people. It seems to be something important, sensitive. Back in 2016, I don't know whether you know, they were added to the Scrum Guide. But as you know, the Scrum Guide is a very concise, very limited document. So also the description of the Scrum Guide is Scrum values is rather limited in the Scrum Guide. But sort of a little history of the Scrum values. So 2002 disappeared, happy to help them get them back on table and back on the radar, let's say. And they're still in my book. I've also added it to the other book that I published last year. I don't know if anyone knows, 97 Things Every Scrum Practitioner Should Know. And this year, finally, created a workshop for the Scrum values to help people discover the value in the Scrum values. And I know that Koen is on the call. Koen, we worked together at NN, sort of my last large consulting assignment. I don't know, by the end of my assignment at NN, I did a in-person workshop around the Scrum values. I don't know whether you were part of that or not.
No, but not I've, anymore.
Yeah, okay. So, but at least I saw value for the Scrum values. Still, it took me about 2 years to finally do something with it. But let me take you to values today in a more condensed way. So the workshop is 3.5 hours. This is only a session of hopefully less than an hour, maybe something like an hour. Now, for me, the Scrum values are also important because I call myself an independent Scrum caretaker. At least I started calling myself that at some point in time. I added to as an independent caretaker on a journey of humanizing the workplace with Scrum. Now, humanizing the workplace is obviously closely related to that belief in the Scrum values. So that's sort of been... And one of my core beliefs as Scrum, but also for the people involved in Scrum, I would almost say the people, the victim of Scrum, but that's not really like that. And that interest in people, working with people, human beings, like humanizing the workplace or creating more humane workplaces, starts with the foundational belief that people are people. Don't call them something else. You know, we like to call them, certainly large organizations like to call them resources. People are not resources. Resources, that's like a computer, a part of a machine, a cog, often replaceable pieces of machinery. People are not resources. People are people. Creative, cognitive, intelligent creatures. Highly complex, often very difficult to work with. That's also a difference with you can't clone them like being a robot, but people are people. That's just at the heart of what we do. I believe it's also at the heart of the Agile movement and even at the heart of Scrum, although it's not emphasized enough. But just people are people. It's like this in the book that I just published that update from. So it's a third edition is out there now since the beginning of this year. Or March. So my core belief, people are people. And I just went through the history of Scrum. So Scrum has been around for 25 years. As from 2005, 2006, it started becoming a sort of accepted way of working. Not everybody was embracing it. As time went by, more and more organizations started doing that. As from 2010, 2011, also really large organizations. I don't know whether it's by coincidence or not, but that was also the time that I sort of virtually moved over to the Netherlands, because I don't know whether you know, but I live in Antwerp in Belgium. And as from 2010, the end of 2010, early 2011, I moved over to the Netherlands because I was working for a large consulting company, Capgemini, and they were having a lot of questions, demands, request for Scrum, and they didn't know how to answer that demand. So imagine how desperate they must have been to come look me up, a little small Belgium, to come over to the Netherlands and help Dutch people embrace and understand Scrum. Did a lot of work in those days with ING, by the way. Also other things I remember, ABN AMRO, even Philips and so on, KLM. Fascinating years. But you know what? Scrum has been around for a long time. And in my, in the meantime, 17 years of Scrum and 25 years of Scrum overall, a lot of good things have happened, I believe. Like the empirical process, the process of regularly inspecting so that we can adapt, has been taking over gradually the old school, traditional sort of industrial based way of thinking, you know, all the sequential way of working, the waterfall process, whatever. And it's really beautiful. But I think it's really, really time for organizations to start embracing and not just accepting, embracing and even more capitalizing on the fact that it's all about people and even more about people than about process. And that seems to be difficult. So organizations, management, leadership, and so on, teams, all embracing that empirical process of Scrum, who is not working in sprints these days, who's not trying to do some sort of inspection adaptation at regular points of in time, but that people aspect of Scrum. And for me, that's so important because for me, Scrum's DNA, meaning underlying under the rules and the roles and the accountabilities and so on, is at least to start with what I call Scrum's DNA. Those rules of Scrum, the roles, the accountabilities, the instructions, let's say, from the Scrum Guide, they only make sense if you understand them from a viewpoint of what we call empiricism, so the empirical process, but also the idea of self-organization. And self-organization is already, that's what we get from that paper, the new product development game. You know, like a sports team, once they're out there on the pitch, on the field, as a trainer, a manager, a director, or whatever, there's nothing you can do. They're on the field, they have to figure it out for themselves during a time box, which is then a match, have to revise their strategies, adapt, find new ways, try to overwhelm the opponent by doing something creative and unexpected. So that's all about self-organization. And organizations embracing empiricism, that's only one part of Scrum. The idea of self-organization, I believe, really lags behind. So I do hope that the next 25 years of Scrum, we sort of restore a balance and get the idea of people more on the foreground. And I believe certainly currently we have really, really good reasons to focus on the people aspect more. This is from this morning. So we're now 17 May. This morning in the Belgium news, there was a message that over the past 4 years, so since 2016 up to 2020, so the last measurement was by the end of last year, the number of people suffering from depression, suffering from burnout, has been increasing on a yearly basis on a rate of plus 10%. So every year, there's 10% people more having to spend a long time, so being long absent from work because of burnouts and depressions. That is not good. It's really not good. It's an indication of the inhumane setup of our workplaces. Now, maybe not really depression, because that's a more general thing, but in general, burnouts are almost always directly related to work situations. Depression is a bit more broad even. So we are not humanizing our workplaces. We're making it worse for people, for our employees, for staff, and not just for employees. I'll come back on that. And by the way, this was published this morning. And I'm pretty sure if you would look up figures from the World Health Organization, you would find out similar increases across the world. So we really, humanizing the workplace is more important than ever. And another way to look at it, and why it's also important, so this is from research from the Gallup Institute. From their research, it shows that the level of engagement of people is generally really, really low. Meaning people don't engage, they don't like to come to work, they're not inspired by their work, they don't get energy out of their work, they don't get a lot of positivity out of their work. They don't buy into whatever the company is doing, they don't believe in it, they just sit around doing a job hoping for a salary, which is for me a sort of sad situation, because think back of how much time you spent at, or today not at, but at least for work. It is sad that you have to spend all those hours during a full working week, a full working year, not liking what you do, not being able to engage. That is not great. So from that research from the Gallup Institute, overall, across the world, you can look up your own region on the screen, by the way. Across the world, they see that only 15% of people, of employees, actually say, yeah, I'm really inspired. I really engage. I feel engaged for my work. I like what I'm doing. Most of the people like sort of couldn't care less, which, okay, maybe slightly acceptable, but 18% of people across the world are actively disengaged. So negatively engaged, undoing the work of the positively engaged people, or even working against their colleagues, working against the company, which is awful. Now, by the way, just as a side note, from the research, it shows that in knowledge work, and I assume that we all, in most of our all applying Scrum and Agile because we do knowledge work, creative work, work for which we need our brains, meaning not industrial work, not manufacturing work, and so on. So in knowledge work, it seems that the overall level of engagement is slightly higher, meaning up to 25-30%, But knowledge work, by the way, in that research also includes lawyers and doctors and so on, and surgeons and those types of people, not just us. It seems slightly higher, up to 30% maybe, but still, that is 70% of the workforce not engaged or actively disengaged. That's not good. It's a sign of the fact that we're not creating engaging workplaces for people. Now, just to free you of the illusion that if you would be in a management position, that it would be better. No, it's not. This is from research from the Boston Consulting Group not too long ago. Not on the wide scale like the Gallup Institute does, by the way, 5 countries in the Western world plus China. But at least I recognize their findings. And their findings were like only 37% of people currently in a management position say that they wish to remain in that position over, let's say, midterm, 5 to 10 years. Only 37%. So there's still people that really want to do that. Only 37%. And it seems that being in a management position is also not really attractive, because only 9% of people say that they want to become a manager or that they want to climb the ladder or whatever. And the number one dissatisfaction with all those people is the fact that, you know what, I only have to implement decisions that are imposed upon me. Now, imagine the low level of engagement of teams and employees. Imagine why. It seems we have created organizations with multiple layers. And the only thing we do, layer after layer, so going from top to down, is we get pressure upon our shoulders and we just transfer it to the people below us. Now, can you imagine the pressure on the people completely on the bottom? The teams, the people actually doing the work. Imagine the dissatisfaction over there. And a lot of those managers, people in a management position, just say, you know what, I just have to do this because I want to get a higher salary, a bigger car or whatever, more status, whatever. And as we all know from what truly motivates people, that is not intrinsic motivation. That is an extrinsic motivator, not healthy. It turns into something toxic. So engagement low, long-term absenteeism is increasing continuously, 10% per year. And even people in a management position don't really like what they're doing. We're in a terrible place. So really 3 important reasons why I think we really, really need to focus on people. And as a lot of organizations are adopting Scrum, I truly believe we can use Scrum to humanize or at least rehumanize the workplace. And that's because we need to focus on those people. Because I believe, and I also know from experience, that more than on the rules of Scrum, the instructions, trying to interpret those things from the Scrum guide as must do and must follow, whatever things, we need to start embracing the fact that Scrum creates, with its rules, Scrum creates boundaries, Scrum creates a frame within which the real success, the real value produced, the real benefits realized will come from how people interact with each other, how they collaborate, what they do with Scrum, how they actually use Scrum. In that sense, you could look at Scrum as a tool. And the tool, you can use it for multiple things. It's how you use the tool. In that sense, it's how you collaborate, how you interact with each other within the framework of Scrum. Scrum just creates a framework with some frequent reminders of to do inspections so that we can adapt to new insights, new experiences, changes outside of our environment, and so on. That's actually the only thing that Scrum tries to do. Beyond that, it's up to us, it's up to teams, it's up to teams within teams, but teams with managers, stakeholders, and the wider organizations to develop better new relationships. And then use the artifacts of Scrum for that. So it's, in the end, all about people. The rules of Scrum are at most a start. So think about it. And so it's, in that sense, it's all about how people behave within the framework, what they do, how they act, how they interact with each other. So it's all about behavior and values. And that's one aspect of the value in the Scrum values. values drive behavior. But like in my workshop, I cannot teach values. I cannot tell people to adopt certain values. I can try to show what the Scrum values are about, how the Scrum values are important given the context of Scrum's DNA, meaning empiricism, which is what we need given the complexity that we're working in, and self-organization. But Scrum is so much more than just a list of instructions to follow. Scrum is what I call a framework of rules, what is described in the Scrum Guide, principles, Scrum's DNA, empiricism and self-organization, but also of values. And as a way also to introduce the new version of my book, allow me to quickly pull up my book over here, my pocket guide. Scrum values are still in there. And allow me to just read the introduction of the Scrum values in my book, if you're okay with that. Yeah. And I'll just stop sharing for now, so we can, you're not distracted by things. So it's chapter 2.7, by the way. This is the book if you're looking. Oh, thank you, Rolf. Oh yeah, by the way, Rolf is here from Van Haren. This is a Van Haren publishing thing. So again, my life at some point in time was happening in the Netherlands. I've got myself a Dutch publisher. Imagine. I don't dare to say that in Belgium. They will kill me, but that's not true. The Scrum values. With Scrum, as has been demonstrated, and I mean in the previous chapters of my book, a framework is created upon which people and organizations develop a working process that is specific and appropriate to their time and context. What I mean with that is how people work together with each other on a daily basis, that is something they decide for themselves. They use Scrum, but Scrum doesn't tell that to people. So they develop a working process that should be specific to their context and even depending on time. So within the boundaries of Scrum, people form organized groups around a common problem or challenge without external work plans or instructions being imposed on them. That's my little definition of self-organization. People form organized groups around a shared or a common problem or a challenge, and no external plans or instructions are being imposed on them. The rules and principles of Scrum all serve empiricism, also known as empirical process control, since this is the most suitable approach to addressing complex challenges in complex circumstances. And as I said, self-organization and empiricism form Scrum's DNA. There is, however, more than the rules and the principles. Scrum is more about behavior than it is about process. In that sense, you can perfectly implement the process of Scrum, organize the events, stick to the time box and so on, and still not create a more humanized workplace. Because there's more. It's more about behavior than it's about process. The framework of Scrum is based upon 5 core values. And I don't know whether you've seen it on the screen. The 5 values are commitment, focus, openness, respect, and courage. And although these values were not invented as part of Scrum, because they're just, those names are just common names from English language, and they are not exclusive to Scrum, they do give direction to the work, behavior, and actions in Scrum. Again, given the need to understand them against the background of complexity, empiricism, and self-organization. Values drive behavior. In a Scrum context, our decisions, the steps we take, the way we play the game, the practices we include, and the activities we undertake within Scrum should all reinforce these values, at least not diminish or undermine them. That's sort of the idea of the Scrum values, a little part from my book. So let me take you through those values. So as you can see on the screen, commitment, focus, openness, respect.
Gunther, can I interrupt you for a minute? There was an interesting question in the chat. Maria did ask, how do you work with the values and humanizing organization? Do you have a practical example of that?
How do you work? As I said, I can't
Or maybe
teach.
Maya, you can explain your question just for a minute.
Yeah, okay. Well, do you have an example of how you work with it? Not in a general you as we all work with it, but how do you do it?
Yeah, well, as with so many things, we've got this beautiful opportunity to reflect with people on how we have been working in Scrum. It's called the sprint retrospective. So at the retrospective, there's two aspects for me that are at least should always come back at the sprint retrospective. So every 2 to 3 to 4 weeks, whatever, looking back at the definition of done and did we create a done increment that was actually releasable and so on, because that's still a challenge. That's more like the technical side of Scrum. But the human aspect of Scrum is for me, how did we feel this sprint? What was our engagement? What were our stress levels? How did we work with each other? How did we use the Scrum framework? And then try to tie that back to, why not, the Scrum values. How did you feel about our commitment this sprint? How did you feel about our focus? At some point in time, even I created something with some teams to help them think about their unfocus, a sort of unfocus metric. Looking back at their sprint, I asked them at the sprint retrospective, also when I was not there, to look back at the sprint and have a look at how many distractions were there. How often were you dragged into stuff that you didn't want to get dragged into? How many meetings were you dragged into that you didn't want to attend? And those things, so sort of an unfocus factor. How often were you pulled away? So using the Scrum values, at least at the retrospective, to look back at the sprint, how was it? And how was it also maybe with regards to Scrum values? And then try to help people see, like I say, the value in the Scrum values. And maybe use them in the next sprint as a team, maybe as a reminder. Now, the strange thing is, talking about rules, instructions, and then values, when I think back of my first couple of years with Scrum, roughly 2003 until 2006, 2007, I worked with a lot of the same people, a largely stable group of people. And one of the biggest difficulties I had after those years is that I would have to explain what we did. Because we did a lot of things almost just out of, I don't know, some sort of common sense. We never talked about, yeah, but this is sprint planning and we should do this and it shouldn't take more than that amount of time. And we really even didn't think about the roles. Yeah, but okay, I was sort of Scrum Master, maybe also helping out product owners and the development team. We didn't think about sub roles, whatever. We just used Scrum and it was fluent. It was great. And I was like, wow, what was then the success? And for me, the success of those years were not in the fact that we were not stuck on the rules. We just worked together. We collaborated. And in the background, we had those values probably in our minds, but even that we didn't make explicit. So, but at least, Marian, I hope that helps. Maria, at least at the sprint retrospective, maybe separate workshops sometimes. But again, I feel I can't teach values. I can try to show and ask questions at the retrospective. Yeah, what does that mean with regards to commitment? What did that do to your commitment? How do you feel about being treated with respect, giving, looking back at the sprint and looking at a certain situation? So as a Scrum Master, try to help people look at the sprint and events throughout the sprint, happy events, not so happy events, expected events, forecasted, not really expected events, and so on, and look at them through the lens of the Scrum values. Yep. Was that helpful, Maria?
Yes, thank you very much.
Okay, you're welcome. So let me take you through this. So Scrum is more about behavior than it is about process. And a lot of things for me start with commitment. Because if you're committed, that means you're dedicated to something, you have to believe in something, you really, really, really are desperate in a positive way to make something happen, to achieve something, because that is what commitment is about. It's about really engaging. It's about dedication. If you're committed, that means you have some sense of intrinsic motivation. It's something you believe in. It's like only 15% of the workforce seem to have, maybe up to 25, 30%. But that's, for me, important. If there's no commitment, yeah, what are you then doing? And a commitment, again, is not about a result. It's also why at some point in time, committing over sprint was eliminated from the definition of Scrum, because it wasn't wrongly intended, but it was wrongly interpreted. In my book and on my blog, I use the comparison with a trainer of a sports team who can say after a game, saying that, you know what, we lost the game, but I cannot blame my team for their commitment. We worked hard, we tried everything within our power, we adopted, we changed, we're sweating, we're tired, we tried everything. We didn't win the game, but it wasn't due to our lack of commitment. So commitment is more about dedication, it's about what do you believe in. So, and that is so important. So are you committed to what you're doing? Are you committed to building a really great product? Are you committed to working with people to do the best you can? And so, and are you given the environment where you can express that sort of commitment? So commitment in Scrum is about dedication. It's an expression of dedication and thereby an expression of motivation, which should automatically lead to focus. Because focus meaning a positive choice. This is what I'm going to do. This is what I believe in. This is what I'm going to try achieve. And I'm going to set aside anything else that distracts me or that takes me away from that commitment. And that automatically brings us to that beautiful statement of the Agile Manifesto, or the Manifesto for Agile Software Development: maximizing the work not done. That is another way of looking at focus. So you're committed to achieving that, to achieving something. That means you're going to set aside all the things that are not really helpful and not valuable against that purpose. That means you're going to maximize what you don't do. That creates focus. Commitment is going to help you focus in that sense. Also what I call acting with agility, looking for a way to make it happen. Okay, so we've tried this, not working. What else can we do? Is there something else? So looking for options, exploration, working hard and so on. So commitment and focus for me are really closely related. Committed meanings, I know what I'm going to do. Focus means this is what I'm going to focus on. And it means maximizing the work not done, which is for me very, very, very important. Now, commitment and focus, like I said, certainly commitment closely related to that idea of engagement. And it's closely, it should be a result of the ability to organize your own work. Remember, without external instructions imposed on you. So you work in an empirical frame. You're going to regularly stop, reflect, look back so that you can change, you can do something else, you can learn, improve, keep doing stuff as a conscious decision, the empiricism. But within that frame of working, that framework, you're going to organize your own work. And every, again, one of my beliefs, people are people. Every single human being has the ability to self-organize. So it's rubbish to say that, yeah, but you know what, they're not ready for it, they're not mature enough, whatever, rubbish. People can self-organize. Any single human being can do that. It's the organizational culture that allows you to do that, that inspires you to do that or not. Yeah? So a manager-led situation, first of all, not helpful, and even, look back, only 37% of managers really want to remain a manager, as they only have to implement decisions that are imposed on them. So that manager-led situation is all over the place, and it's not helpful. It's not helping people to engage. It's not motivating people. And in that sense, silly thing, it's not Scrum. To Scrum is to self-organize. So at least organize your own work within a sprint. But even beyond that, think about for yourself about your team composition. What skills do we need? What expertise do we need? The tools you're using, authorizations you're having or not having, and so on. So there's so much self-organization. And as we all know from Daniel Pink, This is closely connected to autonomy, the ability to organize your own work, and even maybe even your own workplace. Do you have a team space? Are you able to work with each other to self-organize? If the ability to organize your own work within sprints, if that doesn't create motivation, it might mean that this is something I really don't want to do. Maybe you should make yourself a happy person and look for something that you really want to do, that inspires you. So that's why Scrum with self-organization is for me a tool to rehumanize or finally humanize the workplace. Now, as we do complex work, complex challenges, creative work, intelligent work, you can't do it on your own. It means you have to work with other people. Collaboration is essential. So you might be committed to something, you might have a focus on doing work. It's always going to end up with some sort of shared commitment and focus as a group, a team, a Scrum team within an ecosystem, around a product, within a product, within an organization. Now, that collaborating with other people, other human beings that are as complex as you are and as unpredictable as you are, which is beautiful. Now, that requires something from us. It means shifting from what I call red zone behavior here, always transmitting, always trying to win the fight or turning things into a fight, feeling wronged all the time, always long toes, you know what, ego driven things and so on. Moving towards what I call green zone behavior, it is listening, responding, but responding to what you're hearing. Try to add something to that, being non-defensive, being open to people, feeling unthreatened and so on, showing respect for people, being firm about your beliefs, but not rigid. In the end, willing and open to learn, to change your mind, trying to convince other people. That's often where time boxing is really beautiful, by the way. And that is a shift in an organization that incentivizes people for individual performance and a sort of individual hero behavior and putting people on a pedestal all the time. Yeah, but you know what? You've been around for a long time. You know it all. You have to make sure that people follow you. That's often not really helpful. So commitment, focus, knowing what you want to do, what you want to achieve, focusing on goals and working hard to get there. If you're not going to be able to do it on your own, you're going to have to collaborate with other people within the team, but also across the team. Now, that has some requirements for me. It means at least openness. And more than just technically being open for change, it's also being open for working with other people. Working with people that have a different personality, or in my case, very, very difficult, a very different sense of humor. I've got this strange Belgian sense of humor. So openness for the fact that it's about people, not resources, that we are not programmable, that we are not robots. Open for the fact that we are human beings with a personal background. We have a personal life. We have moods. We have moods, swings, with all those beautiful things. Showing openness for that is involved in working with other people and trying to show collaborative commitment and focusing on things together. And also automatically brings us to the next Scrum value, respect. It requires some sense of respect, respecting people's background, maybe respecting people's expertise, but also being respected for the fact that you're new to something, which is sort of the other side of the medal. So complex beings doing complex work in complex circumstances, you can't do it alone. You can have a commitment, you can believe in something, you can have a focus, but it still requires collaborating, interacting, working with other people as a team, within the Scrum team, beyond the Scrum team, with key users, with key stakeholders, with people from other departments. That includes openness and respect. Without those values, you won't get far. You will isolate yourself, you will not be open and so on. Now, openness and respect doesn't rule out disagreement. I would even turn it around. You need disagreement. There's a couple of expressions for that. I call it productive dissent. It's something I like. You can disagree with people. You even have to disagree with people, because doing complex work in often complex circumstances means that there are options, there are possibilities. There's not one straightforward way. There's no linear cause, relationships, whatever. You need to explore options and possibilities together. And that means you have to be open about your views, your options. You want to respectfully bring in those options, listen to other people, learn from each other. That means that what I called over here complete harmony, that is not good. So the absence of conflict, the complete harmony, going into a room, silence, that might look good, but it's not. It is impossible for a team sorting out things together using Scrum because the work is unpredictable, is full of uncertainties, is complex and difficult, with often lots of unforeseen events. That is something you cannot resolve by sitting next to each other day in, day out, not speaking to each other. And having to send an email to each other because you're in an open office space, hopefully makes clear that also not helpful. You need a team space, but you need productive dissent. You obviously don't want your dissent, your disagreement, to become personal, to become a negative conflict where it's about the other person, start fighting the other person, when you start forming camps within the team and fighting each other, and in the end maybe even try to destroy each other. That's obviously not the sort of conflict that we're talking about. But openness and respect, if there's a sense, an atmosphere of openness and respect within a team, it means I feel safe to express my viewpoints, my ambitions, my options, my ideas, my beliefs. And other people will respectfully give their viewpoints, and together we'll figure it out. Within time boxes often, which helps us focus again, but that's the idea. So complete harmony, not helpful, not a sign of openness, not a sign of respect. So, and again, sort of, I know whether that helps, Maria. For me, these are things, those I've got in the back of my head when I'm working with people, looking at the atmosphere in a team, the safety, are people speaking up? Are the same people always holding back, trying to read faces and so on. And look at potentially the level of conflict within a team. Is this healthy or not? Because respectfully entering conflict requires respect, requires openness, and often requires courage. Because it's often not what we used to do. It's not what appreciated. You're in an open office environment, which is great for office work, but not really for complex work for which you want to use Scrum. If you're in an open office space and you don't dare to speak out, you end up with that artificial harmony. You're not figuring out the best possible solutions and so on. But other signs are like silent tension, entering a room and you feel the tension in the room, but nobody dares to speak out, or it's interpersonal and so on. That is in a way fear of a healthy form of conflict. Not happening. You wanna try to create an atmosphere where people figure out stuff together openly. And where even sometimes novices teach masters. That's sort of the openness you want. I've been doing this for 20 years. You're like, yeah, you're very new, right out of school. I'm still going to listen to your ideas. Imagine, you can learn from it, fresh perspectives. So think about it, novices teaching masters. That's really, really important. And then that productive dissent or constructive disagreement, that goes back to that paper that I already referred to a couple of times, the new product development game, 1986, imagine. They call it built-in instability. The teams, in order to thrive, to figure out the best possible creative solutions, be innovative, need to have some sort of built-in instability. And the minimal built-in instability that's described in the new product development game is to bring a bunch of people together that have the skills, the expertise to build a great and excellent new product. And then noticing that, okay, so nobody's going to tell us how to do this. That brings in built-in instability. We've added empiricism or a regular process of inspection adaptation to that to help create focus. But that is important, that productive tension. So courage, in a way, glues it all together for me. Because courage is needed because we face a lot of uncertainties. At the heart of our work, requirements that are incomplete, changing all the time, technology that is not doing what we're hoping it would do, blowing up all the time, changing all the time, it's new insights emerging all the time, things are changing beyond our control in the requirements and also in technology. The fact that we're people, human beings, we've got our flaws, we've got our problems, we've got our great stuff and less great stuff. Or nowadays, this pandemic come over us. It requires quite a lot of courage from people to almost get up in the morning, commit to something, go for it, be engaged, work with each other, figure out stuff together. It takes courage, even more courage, to, in those circumstances, truly embrace Scrum's DNA. Look beyond the rules, or underneath the rules, underline the rules, to empiricism, meaning inspection, adaptation. Don't use those events just to report out. They're not about the past. They're always, should always be about the future. So show the courage to use those events the way they're intended to be, as a way to potentially adapt, identify meaningful, sensible adaptations. Self-organize, don't make yourself dependent on external instructions. And in the absence of instructions, just sit around and waiting for things to happen. It takes a lot of courage, certainly currently, to do that. And it takes courage to embrace those values, to show commitment, to maximize the work done, decide what you're going to do, tell people to get out of the way if you want, or to leave you alone because you're not going to those meetings where you're not feeling valuable anyhow. It takes courage to show openness to people, respect for people. It takes almost courage, strangely enough, to live and enact those Scrum values. So, in a way, without the instructions of Scrum, imagine no Scrum guide existing, and starting just with the Scrum values, I believe that you could almost create or recreate your own Scrum. What is your commitment? What are you committed to in your circumstances? Oh yeah, this is a product, this is a service that we're going to build. Cool, that's my job, that's my profession, that's my passion. Let's commit to that. What is then focus? What are you going to do? What are you not going to do? How are we going to do that together? How are we going to figure out how to work together? How are we going to create focus on doing something without losing the opportunity or the need to regularly change, potentially change direction and learn? You would end up with something like time boxing anyhow. How are you going to create focus within that time box? How are you going to work openly with people, show respect on how to work with people? It takes a lot of courage. But in the end, even with starting with Scrum values, without any additional instruction, thinking about those values in the context of complexity, unpredictabilities, a lot of uncertainties, having to figure out with a group of people that are as enthusiastic as you are, and no external instructions, but a number of global goals and objectives in building an excellent product and so on, satisfying a user base, a consumer base, creating a return for the company. I believe that after a while, you would come up with something that looks a lot like the current Scrum process, because you can't make it a lot, much more simpler than it is actually, that combination of two feedback loops. Yeah. Now, the biggest impediment I see to this sense of agile, inspecting, adapting, changing your mind, being able, being open for people, respecting people, living the Scrum values if you want. The reason why organizations are not really embracing the people aspect is, it seems we have difficulties trusting our people. We don't trust them. Now, in Scrum, in that sense, control, dirty word, I know, but control, between quotes, comes from the boundaries of Scrum, not from breathing down people's neck all day long. And what are you doing now? It does not come from at the review, sprint review, checking in with people's velocity and did you live up to your estimates and how, what did you do, and checking on individual performance. That's not where control comes from in Scrum. Control in Scrum comes in that sense from Working from the outset of the process, meaning the boundaries at the review, and then respecting the fact that it's about a team, it's about value, not about individual performance, not about volume, not about amount of features being created, but about impact generated and so on. So, and then in that sense, allowing and even promoting self-organization. And then get away from that ingrained, we seem to be obsessed with wanting to control individuals. And that is why we're not embracing that people aspect of Scrum. So there's a huge shift we are looking for. So to stop managing for tasks, for individual tasks, for individual performance, individual estimates, and so on. And to start creating, fostering an environment with boundaries, meaning we work in sprints against the goal of creating releasable versions of a product or a service. Within that bounded environment, allowing people to really commit again, to dare to commit, to show that, yeah, this is what I want to do. This is how I will build something excellent. This is what I want to do. This is where my passion is. And leave them alone, at least for a sprint. And then even at the boundaries, at the outset of the process, stop trying to control people. Look what they did. Look at their impact. So, and that is the management shift or the organizational shift that we're looking for. And think back, employees are not engaged. People in a management position don't feel too motivated or inspired either. So this is just good for everybody. It's good for the teams. It takes a lot of pressure off their shoulders. It's moving authority down the line again. Not again, just moving authority down the line. And creating an environment where people dare to commit again so that they can create focus, that they can openly and respectfully work with each other, challenge each other, become better through collaboration, learn a new skill, a new trick from other people, all against the goals and objectives as set, as identified, but not individual tasks and so on. And in that sense, use the Scrum values as a compass. Because, Mary, as you asked the question, but it's obviously for everybody. For me, there's two big ways of looking at the Scrum values. And the first is, it's for me, it's a compass. It sets direction. Are we heading in the right direction? Is this our commitment? Is this what we focus on? Is this how we want to evolve and grow and develop together as a team, as a group of people? Team stability that comes into play, really helpful. The courage to say no to external people messing up your team composition all the time, because it's a result from commitment and respect to each other and respect to the team that we are. So it's a compass, and at the same time, and that's how Ken and Mike Beadle described it in their first book about Scrum, sort of like a barometer of your Scrum. So compass and barometer. A barometer in the sense that we've been doing Scrum for quite a while now. If you're still stuck on the process and discussing and debating the rules and the instructions and so on all the time, it means you're still not really enacting Scrum. So in that sense, at some point in time, living those values, for me, should take precedence over discussing the rules and the accountability. Oh, that's not your job. I should have done that. You know what? You're a collaborative team. So compass and parameters, those are the two functions for me of the Scrum values.
Gunther, I was following the chat, and then one of the things I see in the chat is that people are discussing the word Scrum values, because many frameworks, Kanban has its values, Scrum has values. Many people talk about values. Mark even suggested to call it common sense. So how do you feel about that, and how do you relate, for example, the Scrum values to values mentioned in other frameworks?
Well, let me first start with this idea of common sense. I fully agree that it should be common sense, but I think honestly, certainly in Belgium, let me just speak for Belgium, with this whole pandemic over us, it seems that there are very different interpretations of what people would call common sense. I would call common sense, not going out, not being in a crowd, whatever. Other people seem to think differently. I call common sense, not even sitting on the terrace, not even now that it's allowed. Other people see it differently. So common sense, yes, but you know what is common sense? Although in my Scrum trainings, by the way, I often call this, this is restoring the common to the sense. Because when with people I go through Scrum, the framework, that's under rules and so on, and explain how and why, people say, yeah, but that's just common sense. And I say, yeah, I agree. On the other hand, if this is common sense, why is then just not everybody just doing it? So this difficulty with common sense. How this relates to other values, I don't know. Long time ago, 2003, I started with extreme programming. If I remember by heart, they've got a couple of values, including feedback and courage also. Makes sense to me too. In a way, that's what I've tried to describe, those five words, and in a way, just words. You have to give them meaning. And that meaning in the world, the environment, for which we try to use Scrum, meaning complex problems, complex challenges, full of unpredictabilities, full of uncertainties, away from the waterfall process. That is at least one angle from which to give meaning to those words. Because in the end, it's easy to say those words. But I could also say, long time ago, say, yeah, you have to show commitment by making sure that you deliver by the end of sprint everything that you promised you would deliver. Well, maybe that's not commitment because it drives people to overtime, low quality, weekend work again. That is a false sense of commitment. So in that sense, it requires some courage from Scrum masters, mm-hmm. or coaches, team coaches to be able to help people think through those values. If somebody says, yeah, I want you to commit and deliver this, even if it takes you, yeah, but what if it takes us weekend work? What if it takes us in the end? You know, that sort of work, you also have to redo it afterwards. Is that then truly commitment? Or is the real, the courageous form of commitment? We think this is what we can do, but we accept unpredictability and uncertainties even for a sprint of 2 weeks. It means even in a sprint of 2 weeks, unforeseen things might happen. The commitment, the real commitment is then we will adapt to that. We will embrace that. We will make the most out of it. And we will openly share that. We will not hide that information. And that is commitment. So in that sense, it takes some courage to explain the values and relate it back to how people intend it. And then go back to empiricism, self-organization, and so on. Was that actually an answer on the question? Yeah.
Well, it was a nice reflection you gave on what I thought that the question was. I just pick one other thing out of the chat. AG says, do you measure it, like measuring velocity? And then somebody else said, well, please don't mention velocity. And you also said that measuring velocity can also have its downside. So what is your opinion on that? Having your measurements also in order to improve, but then also keeping close to the values.
Yeah. Well, let me start with velocity first. It's too beautiful a topic. I know the sort of we're growing into a situation, I think that's probably an improvement. People say, yeah, velocity, that's for within the team and nobody else has any concerns with it, fully agree. But imagine the following. Imagine having the courage to share velocity, but also the courage to explain what velocity is about and helping people see that it's not really your concern. We use velocity in this way and so on. So think about courage. And measuring values, I don't believe that's actually possible. How can you measure people's commitment? How can you measure focus? I've tried to help people with some things of keeping an eye on, hey, if you look back at the sprint, just on average, how did you feel about your focus in that sense? How often were you, like I said, dragged away, pulled to meetings, whatever? So try to get an idea of your unfocused time. How much time could you not focus on what you really wanted to do? And What can you try to do about that? Yeah, AI, oh, AG?
AG? Yeah, AJ, AJ, yeah.
AJ.
Yeah, I listen to everything, AJ, IA, RG, I don't mind. So I even listen to whistling. I think you can measure it. And what about measuring, is it better or not? Yeah, so do you feel, we had commitment and we measure commitment. How do you feel about commitment at the moment as a team? And next sprint or next two sprints, let's say, what actions did we take to make it better, make it feel better? And does it feel better? And yes, it does feel better. That's measurement. That's easy measurement. It feels better. It was a minus. It is a plus now. And how do we get it to a plus plus? Okay, let's get it to a plus plus. What are the actions we take to make it a plus plus? And look back at the measurement that it was a minus. What action did we take? It improves. So it's all about improvement together. And I think you should dare to measure those things together with the team to see how it works. Because if you don't do that, then it's a one-time trying to give it something, some feeling about it. And then the next step would be, okay, well, we did that once. What are we going to do next time? No, it should be something always there. And why not in the beginning try to measure it, while in the end, it's common sense, and it's all common sense, and it's all way to work together and to collaborate with each other. Yeah. So that's my measurement, is always trying to improve and make it tangible that you are improving as a team and look very proud at what you achieved together. And you can make that measurable. So measurement is not for me, it's a one and now it's a 10. No, it's getting better. Okay. And what actions did we take?
Okay. I fully agree. But I hope you would agree also that if you mention the word of measuring and metrics, people take it too seriously almost. What you're explaining is cool, because it's visualizing it in that sense, to make it transparent and visible, at least within the team,
okay,
at some sort of scale. So yeah, that's really good.
Okay. Yeah, there's one for me there, because I'm a very result-driven, I'm agile. Project manager, agile program manager. So I'm very result driven. For me, it's a way to get them to a higher state of mindset, yeah, to make it work like that. And if you say measurement and values and things like that, why not measuring it? And why not taking them to a next level, making it very tangible? So that's one of the things. And I always step back when people are trying to, well, keep it on a level of, okay, let's be, what's the word for that? Lightheaded, geitenwolle sokken. Yeah, that's the word that I would call it. Yeah, geitenwolle sokken. But at the level of the very soft coaching. Yeah, take it to a level that you dare to come to result as well. And that is one of my things that I take out of this, what you're saying, because I think it's a very handy way of looking at it. Yes, thank you for it.
Yeah, you're welcome. I think, Maru, you've got your hand raised, if I'm not mistaken. Go ahead.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, Günther. I didn't expect it. I'm going to keep it short then, because so three things. I think what's been mentioned regarding making visible the pain or the trends that people are going through could be very useful if the team decides to. And what I want to say about that is that measuring, when we say measuring, it's not what measuring means. Measure means there is a common concept that is physically quantifiable and everybody can have the same representation of it. What we're saying here is that measuring in the sense of common measure for everybody, but it's a personal measure, a personal assessment of what am I doing along this dimension, let's say courage, respect, etc. That goes towards more coaching approaches. People or teams can decide if they want to keep that private or not. That's the two things. The third one about common sense, just very briefly, is, I don't know if you guys have noticed, but every time people conclude that something is or was common sense, it's only after the fact, it's only in hindsight. It's always once we have understood it and now we have a concrete common representation of what happened and what was the solution or the explanation, then we have a common sense. But before that, there is an infinity of common senses, like Günther said, before we can see it. And so that's a psychological effect that makes people think there is such a thing as common sense, just like there is such a thing as the respect we have in the team. That doesn't exist. It exists only in each other's heads. Thank you.
Okay, you're welcome. Thank you very much. Just to give an example of what I've tried at the large company where I did consulting, I was working with several teams as an external coach, and I've asked several of them to use their retrospective to also, as a team, look back at the sprint, sort of their, in that sense, level of engagement, in that sense, in a more negative way, sort of their stress levels. Sort of how relaxed do you feel? Did you feel stressed enough, but not overstressed, or maybe too relaxed and so on? And I compared it to what I like to do with, I like to go out running. And I've got this watch to sort of measure what I'm doing over that 5K or 10K distance. And when I come back and I upload my data on the computer, I've got such a nice graph of my heartbeat and my speed and so on. And I was trying to get something, and Mario used the word trends to help those team start looking at trends, retrospective after retrospective, some indication of our stress level, so that after a while they could see trends and they could. But again, that maybe AG, you would call that measuring. For me, that was just an invitation to talk about it. Now, the problem is that they focused too much on the measurement and not on the conversation. So they started collecting those things. And after a while, I noticed, oh, you're just doing this because I'm asking you. Must mean I haven't explained good enough or well enough why I want you to do this, why I think it might be useful. You didn't make it your own sort of tool, if you want, your own instrument. Because my idea was to have them look back at, in that sense also, how sustainable is this for you? Because you can have a full sprint. And I was working with them on a scale of 0 to 10. And if your stress levels or your whatever stress levels is sprint after sprint is sort of 8 or 9 or 10, it's too much. You can't keep doing that. You can do that for one sprint, maybe two sprints, but that's about it. So I was trying to help them see, try to create something of a sustainable pace environment for themselves. But I stopped asking because a lot of them were just doing it because I asked them, and it's very polite and very nice, but not helpful. And some took it too seriously. They forgot about the conversation. So in that sense, AJ, it might be that I'm too flower power, but I'm very focused on the conversation. And I like informal, intuitive things, not overly formal.
I totally agree on that one. And I like the word trends, yes. And I also think not mentioning them or avoiding writing them down and putting them on the wall and see that it's improving, I think that's also conflict avoidance. I think the best improvements are in the conflicts. And if you don't see it and you don't say, hey, this was great, but this is even better. How did it get there? And now it's getting worse. How did we get there? There's the conflict, and there's where the improvement lies. And that's the only thing I want to say. So that's why I'm very, well, open with teams, open to put it on the wall and just mention it, name it, but put it on the wall together and have the courage, of course, to do that. Yes. But I totally agree with what you're saying. It should be all there. So it's not black or white. No, it's some way to get it done. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah.
Another thing that this reminds me of, this conversation, by the way, is several years ago, I wrote a little blog note about it, again, about engagement, where I had this question often, Gunther, what can we do to make our retrospectives more fun? And it's like, yeah, fun. It's, yeah. You know, if working hard, if collaborating, if improving, is doing the best you can, if that's not fun, it felt like a lot of people were looking for some sort of very, I don't know, very superficial thing, just fun, dancing around, jumping, whatever, and then happily going home. But for me, engagement is more than just fun. Engagement means engaging. And that's how you remind me of that, AJ. It's about engaging in a conversation. And that's so much more than just putting a dot on the wall or whatever, or even just fun and tap dancing retrospective away. So that's not a sign of engagement. it's so, I don't know whether you agree, but it's so superficial for me, just for, I believe with Scrum, what I've seen is teams working really, really hard and really enjoying that. So fun or joy and hard work, they don't exclude each other. I believe they even go hand in hand.
I saw Maru raised his hand again. I would like Maru to give you the word for the final question.
Final question. I'll make it very concise. Don't you think that when we are talking about these topics, we're actually, any team doing Agile, they're working on what is expected from them as a product output or whatever service they deliver to the organization, but they're also working on their own product, which is the team product, and therefore should be able to track it like they do for the real hardware product, including those values and how they live with them, have it, I'm not saying systematize it, like have a backlog for it, etc., but it, do you see that as a parallel, or is my analogy out of
no if there's a following that you're meaning, one observation that I often have when visiting new teams and so on, having a look at their backlog, and they call it a product backlog, and when I look at it, that is a lot of things, but not a product backlog. That is not a backlog for a product. It is a random collection of work that you think as a team that you have to do, and then relate that to focus. What does that mean in terms of focus? So often teams are working not on a product, but then again, think of commitment and focus. What are we doing and why are we doing it? And then, in Scrum terms, what is our product? What is our service? And are we able respectfully to deliver end-to-end value to users, to end users, consumers, or value to the organization? So I hope that was what you're meaning. A lot of backlogs that teams have is not really a product backlog. It also means that there is somebody having the title of product owner, and that's rarely the owner of a product. Again, for me, focus, commitment. That's how you can use the values to help them think about that.
I think that was a good example. It was insightful on how we could work with those values. And thank you.
You're welcome.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Gunther. Thank you so much for this talk. It was a very nice to listen, very inspiring. Like I said, we have recorded the talk, so we will put the link on our website. We will have more talks like this, so please look at our website. The next talk will be June 2nd, where Linda Rising will discuss myths and how to bust myths in transformations. And also later in June, we will probably have also a discussion with Michael Spade on his view on transformations. So hopefully you can all join then also. So all have a very nice evening and hope to see you next time.
Okay. Thank you all for being here. Thank you, René, again for the invitation. Go listen to Linda and Michael. They both have an article in my book, 97 Things Every Scrum Practitioner Should Know. Really amazing people. So I hope you will enjoy them. Okay, have a wonderful evening.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Bye-bye, everybody. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.